الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير السنن سنن محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب الله العظيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب الله العظيم يا أيها الناس قد جاءتكم موعظة من ربكم وشفاء لما في الصدور وهدى ورحمة للمؤمنين قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا هو خير مما يجمعون صدق الله العظيم My dearest brothers and sisters in Islam My topic of khutbah today is connect yourself to Quran in this month of Ramadan Month of Ramadan is almost coming within a day or two We are entering into the month of Ramadan. And in the month of Ramadan, we have so many important responsibilities and tasks. One of the foremost and very important tasks we have to perform in the month of Ramadan is to connect ourselves to Quran. Because month of Ramadan is the anniversary of Quran. Because Quran says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن It is the month of Ramadan in which Quran is revealed to you. Hudal linnas, it is a guidance to the entire human being. Wabayyinatim minal huda wal furqan. And it has a very clear and distinguished teachings. And it is a criterion to distinguish between truth and falsehood. So it is the month of Quran and month of Ramadan is like an anniversary of Quran. That's why we have a great responsibility to connect ourselves to Quran al-Kareem. It is explained also in the verses which I recited in the beginning of my khutbah. These verses are from Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, and verse number 57 and 58. It says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِذَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ There comes to you an admonition from your Lord. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ And it's a healing to the ailments of your hearts. It's a very beautiful statement. For any beautiful statement, you can see there are two versions or two areas. One is theoretical area and another one is practical area for any statement. For example, if someone says, Panadol is good for fever. It's a true statement. It's a good statement. But if you repeat 100 times, Panadol is good for fever, will the fever go? It will not go. This is just a theory. In order to get rid of fever, what you have to do is you have to see where Panadol is available. You have to go there, you have to get it, and you have to consume Panadol in a proper way with the proper dosage and after the meal, and there are some requisites. And after that, you have to wait for some time. Then your fever is gone. So there is a practical version of it. Unless you take care of the practical version, just plain statement will not give you anything. Like that, if you apply the same theory to this Quran statement of Quran al-Kareem, which says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِذَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ There comes to you an admonition from your Lord. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ And it's a healing of all kinds of diseases in your heart. This is a statement. But there is a practical version of it. There is a practical thing you have to do. Unless you do practical things, this statement is just a statement. And if you see, this statement is in Arabic language. And why Quran came in Arabic language, whereas so many other books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not come in Arabic language. If you see one reason why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sent down His message in different languages, the only one reason behind it is conveying it to the people, the first addressees. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always revealed His verses in the language of the Prophet and the language of the community of the Prophet. The language of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the language of the first addressees of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is Arabic. That's why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has conveyed this message in Arabic. And if you see the status of Arabic language during the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Arabs were lesser in number compared to today. Today, many countries are Arab countries, not only because of language, because of Islam. When Islam went to a place, so many places, people did not only accept Islam, they also accepted the language of Arabic because it is a language of last guidance. And this guidance came in a very lucid and very beautiful Arabic. If you see Arabic of Quran, it is a very modern and beautiful Arabic. And you cannot see that it is a book revealed 1400 years ago. For example, if you take any literature in any language, English or whatever language you want to read it, read the literature written 1400 years back. It is something different. The style is different, language is different, everything is different. But Quran addresses you in a beautiful modern language, and because of Quran, Arabic language became rich, and so many countries became Arab countries. For example, Egypt. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he and his companions sent Amr bin al-As radiyallahu ta'ala to Egypt. When Amr bin al-As radiyallahu ta'ala who went to Egypt with the message of Islam, the language of Egypt was heliography, and people were different kinds of worship people were making, and they were not Muslims, and their language was different. People accepted Islam, accepted the language to the extent that it became the language of the country. Today, everyone is not Muslim in Egypt. There are Christians, there are other communities, but everyone is speaking Arabic language. This is because of Islam. So it is the same scenario in many northern African countries. Take, for example, Tunisia or Morocco or Algeria or many other countries. That's why today a lot of people are Arabs because of Islam. And this statement, coming to my point, is in Arabic language. And Arabs were less in those days. Even today, if you take in a large area of where people are living, Arabs are less in number. Where a large number of people around the globe are speaking other languages. And even if you take Muslims, 80% of Muslims are ethnically non-Arabs. Maybe some of them speak Arabic or understand Arabic, but ethnically 80% of Muslims are non-Arabs and 20% of Muslims are Arabs. So when Quran gives an Arabic statement, how it can become an admonition and advice to the entire humankind, and how it can heal the ailments of the heart. Ailments of the heart here means all kinds of diseases in the heart. Atheism is an ailment. Polytheism is an ailment. Wrong understanding of God is an ailment. And all these things are diseases. And Quran is a healing. Quran is the only book of healing which heals all kinds of diseases. If this has to heal you from all kinds of diseases, entire human being is bestowed with an admonition, then it is the responsibility of the Muslim. Here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala also mentions about the responsibility of the Muslims, that primary responsibility of Muslims is to understand Quran and to practice Quran and then to convey the message of Quran. Then only it will become an admonition to all human beings, and it will become a healing to the diseases of the heart. And Quran continues and says, وَهُدَمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And it's a guidance and mercy to believers. And Hudan, Hidayah, what Hidayah means, the very basic understanding of Hidayah is if a person knows about Allah, And if a person knows about prophet, and if a person knows about the basic requisites of belief, then he is a Muslim and he is a believer. And he is a person who is obedient to God and he acquired hidayah. He is guided person. And this is the primary requisite of hidayah. This is not the complete hidayah. For example, if a person is appointed a CEO of a company, today you can see that after appointing a CEO, many CEOs are famous in the world, that they change the company. They bring a lot of profit to the company. They change the direction to the company and the company will be a different company because of him, because of the role and responsibilities given to him and because of the decisions he makes. So it is not, CEO is a big title, but just a title and just a chair will not make any difference. The real difference is made by the decisions he makes and the role he plays. Like that, hidayah, the beginning of hidayah is of course becoming a Muslim and becoming a good Muslim. That is the title of Muslim, and this is where you have acquired the first level of hidayah. But the real level of hidayah comes when you apply the Quranic principles and teaching of Islam in every aspect of your life. So Muslim will become real Muslim when he applies Quran to his personal life, to his social life, to his family life, to his economic life, to his social life, to his political life, to his cultural life, and everything. If he applies the Quranic principles, then he will become a real Muslim. Then only Quran's guidance reaches everywhere. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, وَهُدًا وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It's a guidance and mercy. The mercy of the Quran you can see in society, within yourself, only when you apply it. Practically, when you can see Quran in the lives of the people. And this is very important. We cannot understand this, for example, dimension that we should see Quran in life of people, because we have a lot of Quran Kareem around us. Quran Kareem for us means a book which is there in masjid. It is a book. If you see it in the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, there was no Quran in the form of book, because the bookish version of Quran was not there. Technology was not that improved. Today you will find not only in the form of book, probably today we are living in a very advanced, very technological advanced society. You will find Quran in the form of a book, in form of CD, in form of mobile applications, in so many other forms. You will find Quran everywhere. And Quran is abundantly available everywhere in every society. But living examples of Quran is not as much as we used to find, or there used to be in the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. People used to live according to Quran. There were real life examples of Quran. When Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was asked, how is the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What she replied, kana khuluquhu al-Quran. His life is nothing but Quran. If you read Quran, you can see the reflection of his life. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions were living the life of Quran, and there was a real life examples of Quran. When there are a lot of real life examples of Quran, Quran will become a guidance, book of guidance, because you can see in trade, in businesses, in social life, in practical life, in political life, in every aspect of your life, you will see Quran. So then there will be a guidance and there will be a mercy from Quran. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, this is a great mercy and blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gave Quran al-Kareem to you. It's a great guidance and great mercy and great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when Quran came, there was no guidance. At least for 500 years or a little bit less, the last version of hidayah was revealed to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, or Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. But it was revealed in Aramaic language, and you will not find Aramaic Quran, Aramaic language of the message of Jesus Christ. You will not find it. Even today you can see what happened to the last message which just came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. You will not find any original version of it. And you ask any Christians, what is the original language of Bible? And most of them will not reply as Aramaic, because very less people know that it originally came in Aramaic language. And today you will find hundreds of versions. And Protestants, they thrown away 18 books of book of Apocryphas, saying that it is a concoction. This is what happened to the last book which just came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then imagine the books sent before that. nothing is there available in original form, and human beings were in darkness. And it is a great mercy and blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ. And it is from the great blessing and great bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He revealed Quran al-Kareem, a blessing, a message which cannot be corrupted, which cannot be transformed, and which cannot be changed. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. It is us who revealed this Quran, and it is us who are going to protect this. So it is fully protected. It can be committed to memory. Only book which can be memorized on the face of the earth is Quran al-Kareem. If you see the huge book or bulky book which can be memorized is Quran al-Kareem. It is a mu'jiza of Quran. It can be memorized by small children. Other books cannot be memorized. So it can be committed to memory. It is fully protected. It cannot be corrupted. So it is the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has revealed Quran to us. And He has protected Quran to us. And He gave us guidance. And because of the Quran, so many people are getting hidayah. And so many people are, you know, it continue to become Muslim. This is all because of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. And this is better than whatever you accumulate for yourself. And this is the best thing for you to accumulate. What we are accumulating? We are accumulating dinar. We are accumulating money. We are accumulating so many other assets. And we have so many things for which we say that it belongs to us. And that is mine. When you say that this is mine, you feel pride about it. But all those things for which you attack, this is mine. Belongs to me. If you see what is the connection between you and that object which you say that it is mine, it's a very minute and very delicate connection you have. That connection is your breath. When you inhale, take your breath inside, and if it stays inside, that things which you say, all those objects which you say it's mine, it's not no more reverse. It belongs to somebody else. The breath stops means everything stops. So many nice dresses you have in your cupboard, and you say that for different occasions I wear different things and it is mine. And if your breath is stopped, then all those things is not good for you. You need only two pieces of dress, two pieces of clothes to perform your last rites. That's all. This is the delicate connection you have with all those things for which you say that this belongs to me. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. And this Quran al-Kareem is better than all those things. Because Quran al-Kareem, the connection of Quran al-Kareem will change your life and give a lot of bounties to you. And not only that, will elevate your status in the life hereafter. Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الْقُرْآنُ وَالسِّيَامُ يَشْفَعَانِ لِلْعَبْدِ. Quran al-Kareem and fasting in the month of Ramadan will intercede with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يقول القرآن إني منعت النوم بالليل. And Quran says that I have stopped him from sleep. فشفعني فيه. So accept my interception for him. And fasting will say I have منعت الطعام والشهوات. And Allah fasting will say I have stopped him from eating and from all kinds of conjugal pleasure. Then فَشَفِّئْنِي فِي, accept my interception. فَيُشَفَّعَانِ, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will accept the interception and give blessings to the slaves and forgive them. So this Quran al-Kareem, if you practice it, if you live with it, if you collect it, if you accumulate for yourself, it feels good for you in this world and good for you in the life hereafter as well. In life hereafter, there will be only currency is your good deeds. And the best thing you can accumulate is Quran. What do you mean by accumulating Quran? And connecting yourself with the Quran. Connecting yourself with the Quran means it is a huge responsibility. It's reading, of course. Reading with tajweed, reading with tarteel, and reading regularly, and making reading a practice of it, regular practice of it. And not only that, understanding. And understanding also, there is different levels. There is tazakkur, there is tadabbur. Tazakkur means the basic understanding. Tadabbur means the very deep understanding. There are tafasir available. And there is seerah available. Read it and understand Quran and see how it is applicable to me. And again, practicing it in your personal life, and practicing it in your social life, and practicing it in every aspect of your life. Not only that, trying to implement Quran in your society and conveying the message of Quran. This is also the prerequisite, and having a very regular connection and living the real life of Quran. This is all the requisite of accumulating Quran. Huwa khairum mimma yajma'un. This is the best thing you can accumulate. And if you do that, and if you follow these principles, then your status will be definitely elevated in society. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Inna Allah yarfau bihadha al-kitabi aqwaman wa yadau bihi akhirin. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will elevate the status of so many communities because of the Quran, because of this Quran, and he will ruin the rest. And in order to understand this statement of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you have to see the historical background of the society when Quran was revealed. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was chosen as a prophet in Mecca, he was living in Hijaz in Mecca. This area was free area, it was not occupied by anyone. And the other places is either belongs to Roman Empire or Persian Empire. All these areas, Iran, Iraq, Syria, and all these areas were either belongs to Persian Empire or Roman Empire. And Persian and Roman Empire, if you see their history, they have thousands of years of civilization. Very strong governments, very strong regimes, and they have the strongest army in the world, and they had their, you know, strategic places everywhere in the world. But they did not conquer this place, Mecca, Medina, and these areas of Hijaz. Why? Because this area had no much attraction for them at that time. There were no bigger resources. There was no oil or any kinds of resources. It was a plain desert. There are some camels, less educated people. Why people need it? They said, we don't want to occupy that. They left it. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he chosen those places to send down his prophet. And he revealed Quran to him. And he conveyed Quran. And for 13 years, there was a lot of opposition. Then he migrated to Medina. When he migrated to Medina, it was not a Muslim country. It was still a non-Muslim country, but a tolerant Muslims were living there. But within a short span of time, everybody accepted and chosen Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as the leader of the nation. Then it became an Islamic territory. 25 years, geography was different. After 50 years, geography was entirely different. Within some decades, not some centuries, within some decades, the biggest Roman Empire and Persian Empire is conquered by Muslims. This is an astonishing history, but it's a real history you can go back and study, that within several decades, those people who were living in a territory, people thought that is they are good for nothing, they became so strong, and they became so powerful, and they became so influential, that they conquered the two biggest regimes of the time, powers of the time, Roman Empire and Persian Empire, and they became rulers and leaders of the world. And after this, you can see that, you can try to analyze, try to find one reason how these people became leaders. If you try to find one reason, the reason is that they are given Quran al-Kareem. When they understood Quran al-Kareem, they practiced it and they conveyed it and they established it in our society. They were different people, they were powerful people. And that's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْفَوْ بِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ أَقْوَامًا. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will elevate the status of the people because of the Quran. وَيَضَوْ بِهِ آخِرِينَ. And he will ruin the rest. And even today, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala can elevate the status of the Muslims if they go back and connect themselves with Quran. Today you can see that even we are in large number, but there are a lot of problems everywhere in the world. There is sectarianism, there is divisions, there is wars, there are crimes, there are all these things. Muslims killing Muslims. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says in Quran, Man qatala mu'minan muta'ammidan fajaza'uhu jahannam khalidan fiha. If a Muslim kills another Muslim intentionally, he will permanently will be in hellfire. So this is what we are doing. We are not following it. So what we have to do is connect ourselves with Quran. Finally, as my time is finishing, I would like to mention one more verse of Quran al-Kareem to end my khutbah. These verses are from Surah At-Taha, chapter number 20 and verse number 124 onwards. It says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنكًا. Whoever turns away from my remembrance, means whoever turns away, here ذِكْرِي means Quran al-Kareem. Whoever turns away from Quran al-Kareem, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنكًا. His worldly life will become narrow. And we have a very tough life. This is what is happening to Muslims today, that their worldly life is becoming narrow. وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. And the day of resurrection, they will be resurrected as blind persons. Imagine you are blind when you are resurrected as blind. Next day, you know, it is when he is resurrected, he thinks he remembers everything, his life and the world, just like yesterday. And he thinks, yes, I was there in Kuwait driving cars and I had everything, all my pleasures. Today I am resurrected blind. I cannot see my wife's face. I cannot see my children. I cannot drive. I cannot do anything. That's why he asked, Lima hashartani a'ma. Why I have been resurrected as blind? I cannot see. قَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. I used to see everything. Why I am blind today? Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. Let it happen like that for you. If you are very angry with somebody, what you say? If something wrong happened to someone who is your enemy, what you say? Let it happen to him. Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. Let it happen to you. You should be blind. أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا. We have given our verses to you. Quran al-Kareem was given to you. فَنَسِيْتَهَا. You have forsaken it, forgotten it. You did not thought ever that I have some responsibility towards it. وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. And we have forsaken you. We have forgotten you. May Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala give us blessing to understand and connect ourselves to the Quran in this month of Ramadan. بارك الله لنا ولكم. ونفعني وإياكم بآياته والذكر الحكيم. إنه تعالى جواد كليم ملك بر رؤوف رحيم ورب عليم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين. أما بعد، فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب الله العظيم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد بعدد من صلى وصام. اللهم صل